Hello, everybody, and welcome back to the next episode of the Thoughtful Solutions Podcast. I'm your host, Matt.
And I'm your co-host, Chris.
Today's episode is going to be talking about food, water, and energy potentials, something very important for modern civilization, and food and water in particular, for the essentially the entirety of human existence. But it's very good to point out what we are able to do today with our technical capacity and how some of those potentials are being squandered. But I think it's going to be a really fun discussion, and I'm looking forward to diving into it. What about you, Chris?
Same, very much the same. Yeah, these ones are really important to me personally. Food is like one of the most important things, I think, and how many factors it affects the world, and then, you know, water just coming in second. So yeah, I'm stoked for this one.
Yeah. So before we get into those three different subjects we'll be touching on, the first big point here is talking about two brief concepts that we've mentioned before in the podcast, but they're going to be even more pertinent when talking about these subjects here. And the first one is going to be the concept of ephemeralization. Again, a term coined by R. Buckminster Fuller. This is the concept of, as technology advances and systems as well, these things are going to get smaller and smaller, and we can do more and more with less and less. And that will very much equivocate in this field as well when it comes to, again, food, water, and energy potentials, as we're going to discuss with some of the technological advances in this aspect. And the other brief thing is the concept of zero marginal cost. So going in tandem with ephemeralization, as we push the boundaries for more efficiency and doing more and more with less and less, we reduce the overall resource input that is required for these different systems, therefore lessening the resource burden that is required to operate these types of systems, thus, again, reducing the overall cost, hence the term zero marginal cost. Now, it's sort of one of those goals that is going to be hundreds and hundreds of years in the future before we can effectively reach true zero marginal cost, if that occurs. But the idea is to try and encroach it as close to that zero cost point, so that we can create a legitimate abundance based off of our technical capacity. But we'll you'll kind of see how that'll play out as we discuss these things, and then we'll do a bit of a wrap-up afterwards to tie those concepts back into what we're going to be talking about today.
Exactly. So to start it off, okay, food, one of my favorite subjects for today. Is a huge part of our life, of course. And, you know, we've had the same traditional methods of farming for basically, like, what is it, 10,000, 13,000 years, Matt, since the
pretty much
agriculture? Yeah. Right about that time. And it's today, to today's standards, especially after the technology just has become so much greater, it's a really old, outdated method that, doesn't quite take into hand the important longevity ideas, things that actually matter for the world in the long run. And we have a few examples that we're going to let you know to kind of highlight what we're talking about. But like one of the first ones, you know, mono farming, monoculture farming, Matt, you know, tell them what the downsides are when it comes to how we do that.
Well, there's a multitude of things. The first one is the environmental cost. As has been displayed throughout history, unless you have regenerative practices, you end up destroying and eroding topsoil. You reduce the overall nutrient output of the soil that you're using to farm, and that can further diminuate crop yields down the line, not to mention that you're doing clear-cutting methods to clear the farmland and the types of ecosystems that you're destroying in the process. There's a whole host of things relating to that. The other thing is the the lack of redundancy that you have with these types of systems. So this can be exemplified by the persistent pesticide use, also by the introduction of GMOs. As we've said before in a previous episode, GMOs themselves aren't an issue, but you figure we are genetically modifying crops to help bring out traits to reduce how pests and different animals might affect these crops, or different diseases, fungi, bacterial, whatever it might be. And if the system was designed to alleviate those issues as opposed to trying to change the organism itself, that is going to show an issue that could be solved with other methodologies as opposed to gene splicing the actual species themselves. And the other big thing is just the amount of resource use. We still pretty much use traditional two-dimensional agricultural methods, and there's a lot of land use, water use, fertilizers. There's a lot of issues that go down the line, the nitrification of water systems, and just the amount of energy and labor resources put into these things. Clearly, it was a lot more labor-intensive back in the day, but even in the modern kind of design that we have going with agricultural yields, we still use a lot of heavy machinery. And while, yes, we might not have a lot of laborers per se compared to what we had eons ago, there is still a lot of labor needing to be done with heavy machinery, setting up, keeping the system going. So there's a lot of different factors that monoculture practices can bring in. But even if it is like a multi-crop farm, there still might be some of these issues carrying over, as opposed to more of a sort of permaculture setup or more of a local garden type thing. This won't really apply to that, or sort of greenhouse type systems being developed. But those are, when we talk about monocultures, we're also sort of relating that to just traditional agricultural methods that we have been using for a very long time.
Yeah, absolutely. And now that are on a much higher scale of farming level, you know, acres and acres of farms out there, instead of the smaller, more individual setups, like you were saying, those are probably don't have the same wide scale issues, but, you know, we have mass farming going on. It's kind of where, like, the heavy resource drainage is being really wasted right now.
And there are two big things we wanted to talk about as sort of the push towards that zero marginal cost and increasing efficiency and abundance when it comes to food resources. The first thing is going to be mentioning some of the technologies. The main one referencing is going to be around vertical farming, which is a very good development. The other one is going to be an increased look at animal agriculture, and not in the current method where we have a lot of packed industrial type animal agriculture systems, which can be pretty intensive on land use and is clearly not good for the health of these animals that we are actually consuming, which diminuates the product down the line, but just animal use as sort of a larger order system option. So I think I'm going to start on that first real quick. So a good concept to consider here is you have arable land. That's the land that could be used. It is clear enough to be used for agricultural practices. This isn't obviously your forests, your rainforests, your deserts, your extremely mountainous regions. These are all examples of non-arable land. And you look at the entirety of the planet when it comes to this resource, and 2/3 of that overall arable land is not suitable for traditional agricultural methods. It might be that there's not enough rainfall or access to water resources. The geography might not be conducive to traditional agricultural methods, or they're just so far out of the way from resource access that it might be a pretty tough venture to get something going in these areas. And when talking about the animal agriculture, this is where it sort of slots into that. Having this 2/3 of the land that we're using be shifted towards that methodology of food production is very much going to be the trend that needs to be sort of cinched down upon. Whether it's cattle farming, sheep, goats, whatever type of crop animal you want to use in this degree, that is the type of land that these animals can utilize to generate food products. And because there is so much of this land available, you're not going to see the super cramped industrial farming situations that we have, like here in the US, where we have those issues with the poultry and the beef industry. It would be more, again, conducive to sort of a free range type approach when it comes to these food systems. But it's just really utilizing what is available and having that be the main focus, because you get a lot of food out of animal agriculture. And yes, there is the time it takes to actually grow the animals, getting them to the right size, and then the processing of them afterwards. But the potential needs to be utilized, because currently a lot of that land is just sitting there. And there aren't really any particular ecosystems that are there that would be heavily impacted by animal agriculture in that way. So I think it is something that needs to really be shifted towards as that kind of food potential.
Yeah. Seems a lot more natural to me the way you describe it there. And also it seems like you could do it with a lot of locally, like local people would be able to know what animals are actually the types that would like that region that you can't grow food on, but the animals are still there. And that's the animal that you would be, and I don't want to just say cultivating, but farming and using for that local area, local geographical area, you know, just letting them range. Yeah, it seems much more a part of like how the world nature is supposed to be.
Yeah, and also animal products are very nutrient dense. So it would be a type of resource that we could utilize to really help create that sense of abundance. And it's something that is, again, as I mentioned, being quite underutilized. So with the potentials we have and the amount of nutrient density available in a lot of animal products, it really is sort of a no-brainer. And one point that somebody might bring up is, oh, the animal agriculture, there's a lot of greenhouse gas emissions that come with that, and there might be pretty big environmental costs towards doing it. And while, yes, animal agriculture does contribute a little bit to the greenhouse gas footprint, it's not as large as you would think. I was originally under the assumption that it was some crazy number that, like, 30-40% of all greenhouse gas emissions from cows and sheep farting all day or whatever contributed like 30-40%. But after digging into it a bit, it really isn't that much. I think it's like only 3-4% of overall greenhouse gas emissions are relative to animal agricultural practices. So I think there's a lot of headroom there for potential. And just really, really creating that sense of abundance.
Yeah. I think methane is the gas you're talking about, by the way.
It is, yeah.
Yeah. And just to be clear, we're not talking about factory farming. It's the opposite of factory farming. I think we're both pretty much against the idea of like the mass farming in that way.
Yeah, because the health of the animals and everything is not being taken into account. So you want to generate a sense that people know that where this food is coming from, it's a relatively good environment. But yeah, so that's really the key thing with animal agriculture, showing that there's just a lot of untapped potential that we could shift towards. But as I mentioned before as well, we also have the concept of vertical farming. I'm very much an advocate of this. I did a project in college on it, and I dug quite deep into this type of system potential. And it really has sort of the capacity to revolutionize what we're doing currently with agriculture. The biggest thing is it gives access to a lot of communities and areas that might not be real readily available to have fresh food and stuff that would typically be shipped in from farming locations, and it allows the production of that stuff to be localized in these areas. Good example, there's a place in Singapore that was a really big proprietor of vertical farming. There was a large facility in the downtown region that created a vertical farming system. And there's a lot of different nuances. I'm not going to go into how the system itself actually functions, but it's a mix of hydroponics, automated systems. You don't need nearly as much people actually managing the system, again, because a lot of it is automated. And due to it being a relatively enclosed system as well, since it's inside of a building, you reduce the amount of pests and diseases, and because you have the ability to better control the environment, you can grow different crops. So you have a lot more redundancy when it comes to, you know, if a disease outbreak does occur, it's not going to hit every...
the whole crop.
Yeah, whole everything, everything being grown equally. So, yeah, and again, because you have such environmental control, you are able to just do a lot more. And not only that, it utilizes a lot less resources, shifting back to that zero marginal cost quote that we had earlier. It very much shows that you don't need as much water, you don't need as much energy, you don't need as much land. You can take up a few blocks in a city, create a structure where this can be implemented, and really provide a lot of fresh food for the community around.
Yeah, I actually learned earlier today that they not only can you go big, like you just said, with, you know, a couple blocks of area, but they've actually got it to where you can go very small as well. And there's a company that's put out almost vending machine sized little vertical farming setups in places like, you know, colleges and malls, where you have the public access to your a fresh good right there, you know, grown in the machine.
Yeah,
that's crazy to me.
That's a really cool idea. And you can also utilize a lot of like rooftop space as well that might just be lost in sort of a highly urbanized structure. So it's there's a lot of potential there for sure. And combining this with an increase in animal agriculture and where you need to, traditional agricultural methods that shift more towards a permaculture type system as opposed to the more industrialized monoculture practice that we have now is very much going to show a big development and shift again towards creating that abundance that we're looking to get towards. So there is a lot of cool things on the horizon, and I'm very excited to see what the next 10, 20 years are going to look like when it comes to food technologies like this.
Oh yeah. So moving on, speaking of next 10 to 20 years, our second topic here, water, right? Another huge, big, it's like the other side of the coin to food, honestly. So, our water issues here, Matt, let me ask you this real quick. What are some other options when it comes to our water issues that we're having? You know, we know that there's only fresh water is a main source that we're using right now, and it's a small, very tiny portion of water that's actually accessible around the world. And it's there's lucrative things going on, there's wasteful things going on. So bust us in on water real quick.
Yeah, so there's really two big mindsets to have here. The first one is shifting more towards a conservation mindset. There are many trends coming about that show we're going to have a lot of fresh water shortages here in the near future, especially by time periods like 2050. and the amount of water that we are using, again, for traditional agricultural methods and just in general, very much show that there's a lot of things that could be shifted towards to conserve what we already have. We are here in Florida. We have the Floridian aquifer. And God forbid the population in Florida gets so large that we start really, really putting a strain on these natural resources. So shifting more towards that conservation mindset, which we're starting to see trends in that regard in different countries, but I don't really think we've seen it to near the extent that we need to, especially here in the United States. But the other thing for the potential is something that a lot of people listening right now might be familiar with is desalinization. There's 96 or 97% of the planet is salt water. And with the RO technologies that are able to utilize that and turn it into potable water is very much the potential that that needs to be shifted towards. And we're seeing it at scale in some areas. Chris had mentioned earlier before the podcast that he had seen an area in, like, what you said, San Francisco or somewhere in California, where they had a desal plant.
Correct. Yeah, they've already got the technology to do it. They're doing it there. Prior to having that plant, they had only, like, imported their fresh water from the nearest river. I can't recall exactly which one, but then you actually broke down the water that this desal plant brings in for them, the cost of it versus the cost of importing water from other places. It's actually practically equal after already building a desalinization plant.
Yeah, and there's also a lot of cool examples, especially in the Middle East, where it's fairly hard to get access to water resources. Countries like Iran, Iraq, Israel, United Arab Emirates, Qatar, places like this, probably Saudi Arabia, all these areas very much rely on desal to be a good source of water production. So we already see those trends in regional areas in the globe that don't have this kind of freshwater access. But also, as we've talked about before in other podcasts, the pollution aspect of industry with these entities looking at it as an externality, we are also seeing sort of the sullying of these freshwater resources. And lakes, rivers are drying up, being polluted, and God forbid we get 10 to 20 years down the road and the freshwater that we have access to is being reduced at such a rapid rate, it's very much going to cause a crisis. And there's a lot of trends showing that we really could be hitting that point in the relatively near future. So shifting towards this sort of technology that allows us to mitigate these things is going to be very important to help mitigate a lot of these disasters down the line.
Right, right. You know, improving our conservation and then investing more to these other methods. What was earlier you told me as well about the basically man-made wetlands that that was also being used to filter and clean water?
Yeah, you can. There are certain projects. I talked to an individual when I was at work who was a part of a project building a man-made wetland in New York State, where it was used in a similar vein to a water production plant, where you created, again, these artificial wetlands that would take wastewater and stuff that needed to be filtered. And as it went through this system, it would generate potable clean water at the end. And this is another cool methodology for really using nature's ability to filter water and to have that be sort of an onus for another type of system that could be used in conjunction with traditional water production and acquisition methods, which I think would be really cool. And obviously, with it being a natural system as well, it's going to be a little bit better in terms of its impact on the native environment and whatnot. As
exactly,
you know, us being in Florida, as I just mentioned, we have the Everglades, which is one of the biggest natural wetland systems, and seeing how much it's been impacted over the last 50 years and its reduced capacity as we as humans sort of encroach on its natural area. God forbid we lose such a treasure like that, that has the ability to really create the kind of water we need to live. You know, it'd be a real tragedy to see something like that fall to the wayside. So maybe a model like this could be used in addition to rehab projects to really take the load off of these sort of systems.
Yes, especially, again, in the long run. You
know? Yeah, that's the big thing. And a lot of these technologies, they're not being, you know, especially we had just mentioned the food stuff as well with animal and vertical farming. But all of these types of things are not short-term profit gain type systems. Capitalism is not going to look at this as something that you're going to see an instant return in the next annual reportings or in the next financial quarter or whatever. These are long-term investments that are going to pay for themselves just based off of what the technology is doing. And I think that's a big reason why we're not seeing the sort of implementation on a larger scale, is a lot of these private entities that have that pure profit motive don't really see the money there because of the shift towards that zero marginal cost. Whereas it's more cost effective to just set up a plant, set up a bottling facility, whatever it might be, pull from the spring, pull from the aquifer, grab water from this lake or river, because you don't need the amount of legwork that it provides. But it's also very short-sighted, because as those resources really become dragged down upon, you're going to see very much a reduction in what these systems can output.
Yeah. And it's not being replenished as quickly as we're actually taking it out.
No, yeah, the recharge rates are being exceeded, and yeah, it's just another externality, man. It's something that is just not accounted for with what we're doing, especially with the water systems. But also, yeah, again, with vertical farming, it's something that the technical potential and its ability to create abundance is clear. It's there. I think everybody can see it. But in the current paradigm, there's just little to no profit incentive towards shifting towards technologies like this. So,
yeah.
Well, once we see that reality and paradigm change, the technical ability for us to shift towards those things is really going to come to the forefront, and it'll be the biggest onus for us to really shift to these things, because it's very much a long-term investment. It's a long-term type of point of view that you need to have to really see the benefit that these systems bring forth.
Yeah. Kind of like you want to think about the world in 2040 and what you're actually going to be dealing with. You know, how would you like to guide us to those years, those later years? I did see a very good note, Matt, actually, earlier today as well, about some vertical farming success that's been going on in 20, as far as 2021. And it was something like 54 to 58, I think, percent of the vertical farming out there right now was actually seeing profit. And then another 20% was breaking even. And then whatever was remaining, obviously, was at a loss. But then a lot of those farms that were at a loss were first year and not fully established yet. So it's actually looking like it's now. It could start happening now.
Yeah, it's one of those things where it's going to be a sort of a slow system shift in the current paradigm, and it's not going to be as easy as getting subsidies and loans and just setting up your own traditional farming methods. But yeah, I mean, the trends are there. We are seeing the developments occur again in the current system and paradigm. just not to the degree that the shift needs to occur at. But mm-hmm. yeah, it is very good to see that these types of things are coming to fruition, again, with vertical farming and desal and whatnot. But it's just going to become that much more important as time goes on. So hopefully we'll see those trends change for sure. But
yeah.
that is a good sort of point to lead into the energy side of things.
Right. Our third topic.
Yeah, the third thing here. So overall, when it comes to energy production, it is about a mixed system approach. You have to see what regions are conducive to different energy production methods. Clearly, an area like Arizona or Mongolia or Sahara or something like that, ridiculous, is going to be a very big place for solar. Offshore wind farms are going to be a big potential there. But one thing I think that a lot of people really don't know a whole lot about or are unfamiliar with the potentials is with geothermal. I think geothermal is the biggest potential energy source that we do have a few examples of countries that really have that as their main energy production method, but it really should be the main sort of system that we utilize for energy production, and everything else kind of feeds into a redundant energy grid for different potentials and environments. So there are countries like Greenland and Iceland that get almost the entirety of their energy production out of geothermal systems. And to give a bit of context as well, I think the human population throughout the entirety of the planet currently uses around half a zettajoule of power. And if we were able to tap into the fullest potential of geothermal energy that's in the crust and the mantle, we could probably have over 13,000 zettajoules worth of energy potential. So just seeing where that energy is and how much capacity we have to grow in the future and to have that system be a main driving component, it is very much something that should be shifted towards. And clearly compared to traditional energy production methods with fossil fuels that we see now, geothermal has little to no pollution cost. The biggest component here is when it comes to actually drilling the geothermal well and getting down deep enough into the earth to harness that heat. But it still uses a lot of traditional methods of shifting the temperature of water to create steam to power turbines and whatnot. But you don't see the sort of pollutive outputs that we have with these current energy systems. Also, the footprint is very small as well. A geothermal plant has a very large per acreage energy output, clearly depending on how much need that you're trying to acquiesce and meet in the system. But it's one of the main potentials that I think we really need to shift towards. So looking at these countries, looking at what is already occurring, but also knowing where we could be as well, is very much something that's important to look at.
Right. And that's along with, like you said, the mixed systems, using all different types of methods around, you know, based off where you're at, basically. And then, you know, you have a pool of multiple different sources of your energy.
Yeah, you combine that with, again, like the offshore wind farms, which are absolutely amazing with their potentials, as opposed to just regular land-based wind farms. You combine that with burgeoning technologies like tidal energy production methods, which are in their infancy, but they're coming about. Clearly, a lot of cities and communities lie on coastlines, so having that be another energy production method would be really, really great. And then, as I mentioned, when getting onto this topic, mixing that with solar, just really having a combined arms approach is sort of the methodology we need to look at here. And solar does come with some downsides. Clearly, the production of the solar panels using rare earth minerals, depending, you know, at least with current methodologies, can be quite resource intensive. and the durability of these sort of things can be quite ubiquitous depending on the environment that these panels are put in. And the potential is there. We are obviously already seeing solar farms being utilized, but just having it, again, as another tool in the toolbox is really the perspective that needs to be utilized here.
There's actually a solar field being built outside of the river house. Huge, huge in the mofo, I'm not going to lie.
Cool.
I can't wait until it's completed, because I know that my family that lives out there is going to get the details on it, see if there can be like a new solar grid for their neighborhood. I'm stoked.
Yeah, that'd be really cool. And a lot of these systems also are just easily automated as well. There's a lot of potential there to really take out the human labor portion of things. So that's just another element of shifting towards that real, you know, a lot of the concepts we talked about in the New Human Rights Movement episode, and shifting towards that automation mindset is going to be very, very conducive to these system changes as well.
I see what you mean. With all of these methods that we've brought up so far, they could be automated to a pretty high degree.
Yeah, and just as I had mentioned in the food and water segments as well, the reason you don't see geothermal as widespread as it could be, again, is just due to the current paradigm. You clearly have the fossil fuel industry that has no structural incentive to change the current way that energy is produced and utilized. See them being heavily subsidized, a lot of technology being invested in oil drilling and power plants utilizing these sort of things. There is definitely a system fighting back against what could be done in that aspect. And also with the profit motive, there's, again, just not a lot of money to be made because it is such cheap and readily available energy that doesn't have a lot of those downsides and is not as heavily subsidized and does not have such a large market share when it comes to the energy sector. It's really much the system fighting back at what could be the next big thing that really changes the energy paradigm.
Yeah, you can't start affecting their money or their bottom line. That's they're going to hold on to that.
So that's definitely a reality of why we aren't seeing all three of these aspects and the different technologies and potentials that we've talked about being implemented at this current time. We can see inklings here and there, little pockets of different projects and things moving in that direction, but the system itself is already so ingrained with how things function that there really is no structural incentive once more from this perspective for these types of companies and institutions to change what is already occurring. So I think going back to what we had mentioned at the beginning of this podcast episode as well, looking towards zero marginal costs and affirmalization, these are examples of where these types of aspects and systems really start to align to make things more viable. You can see that with a lot of these technologies having a lot of abundance potential and a lot of technical growth as the systems get developed, the potential is clearly there. And it's a matter of just trying to shift the system towards these types of developments. And we can start to encroach more on those zero marginal cost type realities. So it's very much a other incentive outside of the system that should really start to drive these changes as people become more aware of these potentials and these kind of concepts. And this really just feeds back into the viable system model that me and Chris on this podcast really try and push as a reality that needs to come forth. Because as, again, we all can see, system is not viable in its current implementation. But I think that is pretty much the discussion today here, folks. Just wanted to touch on these subjects. I think it was very cool to help get some of these ideas out. And definitely do a bit more of your own research into these different types of aspects of food, water, and energy, zero marginal cost, ephemeralization, and the realities that these might bring about. And I think it'll really start to open up your eyes to look at these types of realities in a different light, as opposed to what the current paradigm incentivizes.
Exactly. So,
I think that's going to be it, everybody. So we'll catch you in the next episode. Have a good one.